Hi there, Mr. Automation is back, and today with a video on Saltstack and how to use state.slsid. You can do some nice stuff with that, and I want to teach you that. And go to the agenda, some short slides. Not much slides, to be fair. So the agenda is state.slsid. It's a part of the state module. We are going to selectively apply a state or a state ID from a state. Well, so that makes sense when I show it. I do a demo on a static method, so sort of a static name. I also do something on a dynamic method, so based on pillar data. So basically the title is constructed on the fly, sort of dynamic, when we can also apply those states or titles individually. So it's very nice. I do a demo on some Git, and because we're going to make some changes, I'm going to commit that. I show you how the file server update works in Salt. Again, I'm going to do a demo with static and with the full state and dynamic. And this doesn't make much sense yet, but it will in a second. And I made a small overview of my environment, so to speak, that we are using for this test. So this is my Windows 10 box I'm sitting on now. That's my gaming PC, and I have some shells running here. I'll clear it, by the way. I have some shells that runs under the Windows subsystem for Linux, and you see I have a couple of flavors there, and I'm using Ubuntu now. And so I'm sitting here, and now I'm sitting on this network, right? And I have a router and a firewall inside of my home as well, or in my data center. And then I have a separate network here for servers. And I have two test servers here we're going to play with the states. This is my Saltmaster that runs on CentOS 7. And this is my GitLab server that, so that we pull and push content to. So Salt gets the project, so to speak, there, right? Let's take another color there. Take a blue pen here. So Salt gets the content from GitLab, and then Salt can push that to your minions, so to speak. Like that, right? Yeah, so that's some background information on how my environment is set up for this specific demo. And let me show you the virtual machines I created for that, because I created a couple. Yes, they're there. Test 100 and test 101. We're going to play with those systems. And let's go back to the demo. So state.slsid. Part of the state, we're going to selectively apply a state. And what does that mean? You know, it's a little cryptic, you know, here on the screen, some text, and I'm trying to explain that now. So for instance, you have a state file, right? And it can be a very large state file, and it can exist of several state files. You know, you can include files on abstraction layers, you know, you can include several states as substates, for instance. But for now, we have one state here. And this is my Linux-based state, and sometimes you don't want to run your whole state, you know, perhaps you destroy some, you don't totally trust it, you don't want to have that overhead, you know, of running all those steps over and over again, because you only changed, for instance, one step. This one I just added for text. Okay, so let's imagine this step, we only want to execute this demo command now. It makes no sense. I do an ls minus ltr on the root directory, but it doesn't make has not much value, I mean, but still it's for demo purposes, right? We only want to run this step. Imagine that step will be a little bit more exciting, of course, inside of your state, running a script or something, perhaps some sub items even below that. I'll have some demo examples on that as well today. But for now we're only interested in this some demo command, and we don't want to run the whole state. You know, when you run the salt command, I'll show that. I've test 100 system, for instance. At first we'll see if it's up and running. And it is, and then you can also do a state dot apply, and I call it Linux base. Base, and I do a test equals true. Okay. Let's see what happens. So, what you see now is that that whole state, you see all those steps that you see here. You see, it's a lot of steps. This some demo commands, you see, that's our one here. That's weird. Size it up a little bit more. That's our one, this some demo command. And that's here as well. See, with the ls minus ltr. And but you see the other steps as well. Remove yum repos, enable mlocate, enable the epel. There's a lot of overheads, you know, and you don't want to perhaps run that over and over again. So I created this video to teach you how to avoid that, so you don't need to do a state apply, you know, this one, all the time on the whole base, but you can selectively apply a step. So now I'll teach you how that works. So you can also do a state dot sls underscore id, right? And then still you have the same state you want to run against, but before you want to run the state, you also specify the step you want to run, and that's the title. You go back here, and let me see if I'm still recording. Yes, thank God for that. So this was the title. Go back here to the shell and we stick the title in. And because it has spaces, you need to surround it with quotes, of course. I'll paste that in. If I copy it, I'll paste that in. And that's the name. And I do a test true again. Let's see what happens here, okay? So it was very quick for starters. And you see that it only ran that sum demo command, right? Now you have some trust, you know, I dare to run that. Now I actually execute that only step. You see this is the ls minus ltr that was executed on the root directory, as you see here. But nothing else from the state was executed. That's pretty cool, right? And this works, of course, on any state. And if you write some more advanced states, you're also going to get into sort of dynamically build up titles. And I'll show you what I mean by that. First, let's go to bed. So we did the static, and now we go to examine the dynamic example. And I'll show you. Because I made an example already for that. And I will explain it, of course, and I will zoom in on the relevant part only. Try to disable as much noise as possible on the screen. Yes, that's the complete loop. Okay, so what is this loop doing, right? It gets some data from pillar. And which pillar? Linux servers. So I have a project here, or a pillar data branch in my Linux base Git project. I have a pillar data branch. Inside of that pillar data branch, you have a top file on which you specify who receives which configuration. And I did it like this. So all those machines that start with test get this Linux baseline assigned. And this Linux baseline is then inside of here. It's called linux-base.sls. Okay. If you open that, you will see Linux and then servers. And if you go back to this example, you see that we refer to that Linux servers. So that's available on all my minions, on all those test minions. And if you want to see if that's actually the case, you just do a salt test star, and you do a pillar. I mean, pillar. What items? We enumerate the pillar data. Let's see if we get those test values. And I think we can even do a pillar.get on Linux. Let's see if that works. And I think I need to specify the salt environment if you do it that way. Yeah, fair enough. So you see now we have the servers, test one, test two. We have that now available on these minions, right? As we specified here. Right, let's size it up. It's very wise, I think. So here, right? I'll show you once more where that came from. So this is my project, right? I'm working on now. I have this init.sls inside of my Visual Studio. You see that? The package Microsoft. I'll show you. See, that totally refers to the file I have open here. And I'll show you. You see? That looks the same. And inside of this project, I also have a pillar data branch. And inside of the pillar, you have a top file. In the top file, I included that Linux base, right? Linux base. And inside of the Linux base, I call it Linux. You can name it whatever you want, of course, and servers. And here we refer to Linux servers. Okay, fair enough. So what we do is for each item in those Linux servers, so for what for each item, test one, test two, right? We construct a title, and the title will be item. So test one for the first, and test two for the second. That's the for each loop, right? It goes to iterate, so to speak. And then I set the command to run. I just echo the current item we have here and just rerun that. And I made an example of how you can run several commands as well in one cmd.run, just for demo purposes. And here we create another title. So I'll show you even that in the for each loop, now we have dynamically built up titles, and even we can selectively get this step, for instance, only execute this step in this for each loop and skip this one, for instance. We can really do that. And the other way around as well, we can also run only this item step, this one, and we can fully skip this one. That's pretty cool. So here's the command constructed. Here it's executed on line 55 and 56. Then we construct another one with sort of the same title, right? With again the item, right? Test one, test two. And then I append the word test to it. It doesn't make sense, but just for demo purposes. And then I execute that command again, and I echo again sort of the same to the screen. And now I'll show you how we can actually get into those dynamic titles. First, I'll show you how a git commit works, right? I have here, let's see if we have something to commit. Git status, yes. I modified my init file, and that's this file, of course, that we had open here in the web browser as well. And I can do git commit -a, I said, -m, and then adding loop. Git push. Okay, and now we have those changes available in my GitLab environment. But your salt master is not yet aware of that. I'll show you that with the file server update, right? File server update process I mentioned here. That's really needed. You can wait as well, but it's sort of hidden hope otherwise. I always do a salt server.update, and I have it here still in memory. And that now get all the content from Git, so I just committed, and we are sure that the minions will receive that as well. I clear the screen, some real state, and we run that state SLS, some demo command again, and now we basically do a state apply on the whole state. That's equals to, otherwise it's perhaps difficult to understand how I retrieve those individual steps. Those were dynamically built. I'll show you that in a second. So now, for instance, you have an ID here. So that's the key, the IDs. Those are those SLS IDs I was mentioning here. Those are states IDs. They need to be unique as well. Keep that in mind. Cannot construct two times the same name, for instance. Also not in states that you include. So if you have nested states, like several abstraction layers, keep in mind that the title needs to be unique. And here you see, for instance, two steps running. Those have the same ID, but that's normal because we have that ID here. We're just running two commands there, right? It's still one ID, doesn't conflict, you see. So it looks like we have two there, but we don't. And then we have a test run and test one. Okay, now if this is the whole state, you see, remove the ops, remove the yum repos, but now, for instance, we only want to run this test two step, right? So we can do that. We go back to this guy, and then you do a state sls underscore id, And then we specify the name. I have it on my clipboard. I had it on my clipboard, I mean. Text load too. And now you can still do this, of course, but now it's not needed because it doesn't contain spaces. So you can leave it like that. And we do still test this too. Let's see what happens. You see? And now only that specific test step run. And that this is not a static step, like I showed you. You see? This title is here, dynamically built. So for instance, let's play a little bit with the pillar data. Just add an item here. So for instance, we have a test 03 now as well. And I commit that. And after committing, updating your Salt file server, always do that just to make sure that you have the latest content available in my environment. It goes pretty quick, it's 7 seconds, so that's not bad. Then let's just try to run a test 3 now, right? We just added that step. Let's see if it's available. And imagine you're actually doing something with that value, of course. It does not. Okay, that's interesting. Did we actually call it that way? Yes, we did. Perhaps that data is not yet available. It can be the case. Sometimes pillar data is a little bit behind on the Git FS sync. I saw that before. Okay, that's interesting. How? Yeah, and now it's available. It indeed it took some time. I rendered it before it was in there, but now I see a test 3 here inside of the full state. By the way, I just ran a full state. I wanted to see if that step was there, and it was. And I did a test, by the way. Now we go back to this SLS ID, test ID, test 03, I mean, from the Linux base. Test equals true. Okay, nice. And there you have it. Only that test step run. And we go one level deeper. So I showed you, we can also run that and append, for instance, this test value, then only this title will be executed. And you will see a different output there. Mark is crazy, but Mark plus step will run, and this guy won't run. And so we do that. Go back here and test, and I just append test. And why do I append test? Because I do that here as well, right? I append here with plus what's currently inside of item, and that's test 03 in my case, and I append test on that, right? And then only on test 03 this step will execute. On the other ones, on test 01 and test 02, nothing is executed. So for instance, you have some couple of servers there, you only want to run on one, you know, or you have some flexibility there. So now we append the test there. We apply the Linux base again. Let's see what we get back. You see now the test 03 test only runs CMD, and now mark plus extra step test 3 would have been executed. And that's exactly what we have here. Extra step would be executed. And perhaps if you remove the test line, it will actually execute some values to the screen. So let's see. And you see it did it. Standard out mark plus test step 03. Test 03. And that's exactly what we constructed here dynamically here as well. And you see that this step is skipped. It's totally not executed. And we don't really have hard-coded values here, right? They live inside of the pillar data. So imagine power behind this. Let me go back once more here. So I showed you a Git commit after some changes. The file server update, I did a demo on static, I did a demo on the full state, and I did a demo on the dynamic as well. Let me go back to this picture again. Perhaps I need to explain something. I'm sitting here on my Windows box. Yeah, perhaps one more thing. I'm sitting here on my Windows box and executing commands, of course, to my Saltmaster from this shell here, right? I'm sitting there and I'm executing there. I'm giving orders to Salt, and Salt is then executing it on those minions, of giving the instructions to the minions, sort of speaking, and then the minion will execute. And when the minion is done, of course, it will pass that result back to the Saltmaster, right? And that Saltmaster will nicely present that back here to my shell I had open. And that's what we see here, of course. That's the result coming back from the Saltmaster. I think that was it. Yes, that was it. Okay, thanks again. Thank you very much for watching, and perhaps see you again. Bye.